Hi, I'm Rick Telbert for CPA Trendlines, and today we have Gale Crosley, a CPA firm growth consultant specializing in mid-market firms. She is a Hall of Fame consultant and a top 100 most influential person. And Jeff Mowery from Mowery and Schoenfeld in Chicago, a very distinctive firm that a few years ago embarked on a transformational path toward growth in which Gale was a key figure. Greetings, Gale. Greetings, Jeff.
Greetings.
Good morning.
So Jeff, tell us a little bit about the firm. What is Mowery and Schoenfeld?
Yeah, our firm is a large growth firm in Chicago. We were founded in 1996 by Jeff Mowery and Keith Schoenfeld. We have we've been a full service firm ever since, and we work in a wide variety of clients, private companies, and we built a firm over the past 23 years that has been really transformational, I think, in our area of the United States. We have put a great emphasis throughout the time that we've had the firm on the development of talent, with the idea that if you have great talent, you can accomplish everything. So we started very early on looking at the type of firm that we wanted to be when we grew up. And so our philosophy was to start acting like that and start recruiting at college right away when we just had a handful of people. We've been very successful at that in bringing in talent from the college ranks and having people progress to our firm. We have 10 partners today. 4 of them are working in their first job in accounting. So they've come into our firm, come all the way up to the ranks. Our clients are primarily private companies, successful companies that we help, and we help really assure and enhance their overall success. That's really our philosophy, to work with them proactively, to help them grow and expand their business, with the idea being that the best way to have a successful firm is to have successful clients. So we've worked on that. We've had a very forward-looking approach, not focused as much on compliance and helping our clients grow. So, and we've grown now today, after 23 years, our budget revenue for this fiscal year is $17 million. We have 85 total employees and expanding, and we're on a really tremendous growth trajectory right now. We estimate our growth to be about 15% for this year, year over year. We have some real solid, things, really clicking on all cylinders. And so we're ready to take the next step. The next step is important to us because we are, unlike a lot of firms, we have such a talent pipeline that we have to be bigger. We have to grow. We have to double our size in 5 or 6 years so that we have a career path for our people to come up through the ranks and perpetuate the firm going forward. We have the talent to carry the firm forward in the pipeline. We just need to make the pie bigger so that some more people can participate and have a great career with our firm.
Those are huge, awesome goals, doubling the size of the firm in the next 5 or 6 years. But you've come a long way. What was it like when you started?
Well, you mean back in 1996?
Back in 1996. Or even before that, when you were in college and thought you were going to be a political science major.
Right. Well, I started my career with what is now Grant Thornton, with Alexander Grant & Company in the tax department. And I worked there for 5 years. And while I worked there, I went to law school as well. So when I graduated from law school, I spent 4 years as a lawyer with a small firm in downtown Chicago that primarily did taxes. And then I really found at the end of that 4-year period that I really found that after experiencing both, I was better suited for accounting. Okay, I liked the relationship that you develop with people that's ongoing, that you have clients that you talk to all the time. Law is very transactional. You may work with a client very intensely for a few months, and then you wait till the next deal or the next transaction to come along. And so I like the relationship with clients and helping them, and I really felt that my skill set was better suited for that. So I joined a firm up in the northern suburbs of Chicago, where I spent 9 years, and that's where I really became, really honed my business development skills, if you will, was with that firm. But we decided, my partner Keith and I, we were met at the firm, and we decided that we wanted to go our own way because we wanted to operate the firm as with more of a one firm concept, where we were working together as a team on clients. Keith was an auditor. He worked at Crow, what is now Crow Horwath, came up to the ranks there. So we had when we started the firm, we had a tax department and we had an assurance department, even though it was just the two of us on folding tables. And so we started modestly, but we always had that approach of of really trying to help clients be better. Okay, working with clients that want to be improving and helping them get there. And we were also fortunate that both Keith and I were really pretty good at business development. He's 8 years younger than me, but we were really good acquiring clients, bringing in clients. Both of us had that, so we had that big advantage going for us. And then we also kind of backfilled with talent to get the work done. So that's our story. And my story is Keith was initially managing partner with the firm. I became managing partner in 2008. Okay, and when I became managing partner, we had about $3.5 million of revenue. So in that 11-year period, we've gone from 3.5 to about 17 million. We've done some mergers, which I'll talk about in terms of why we got to a point where we felt like we needed to work with Gale. And then we've also, had really we did our last merger in 2016, and we've really had some stellar growth really kicking in on all cylinders, the last 3 years.
It was two guys, a couple folding tables in 1996, and by 2008 it's $3.5 million, and you're ready to put on the afterburners.
Right.
What was it about that point in the firm's development? What was it about that point in your own development that made you realize that it was time to get serious about growth, or to decide to do something transformational? What was that like?
I think that came a little later, actually. Okay. We were still on a trajectory. We wanted to grow. We knew we it was sort of like the same philosophy. We've got the talent. Now we've positioned ourselves. We can grow. I think the more transformational event came a little later. Okay, we got to a point in where our revenue got to around 7 million. Okay, and part of that was some of that came through mergers, a couple of mergers that we did. And so we got to about 7 million, and that is from what I understand, is a kind of a pain point where you kind of exhaust the capacity of the founders to drive revenue, to drive the firm, and you got to start building in infrastructure and different things within the firm to really push you forward to do this. We were kind of at that pain point, and so where we were at that point, we had done two mergers, and the second one did not go very well. Okay, there was a lot of issues, some hubris on our part, thinking we could do anything, and we had a merger that did not go well, that caused a lot of problems and everything, and we realized that we've got to be more strategic about the way we grow our firm. Okay, we can't just grow through mergers. We have to be thoughtful and strategic and get our growth engines going as a firm. And so I had always, during the time, I've always gone to conferences and different things and other outside resources and everything to bring into the firm, because that's how I saw successful companies. They do that. They reach outside the organization. They participate in whatever industry they're involved in. They get resources. They bring in experts. And so at that time, attending one of these conferences, I heard Gale speak. I'd heard her a couple times. And I was impressed with what she had to say. And we really were at a point where we had to do something different. Okay. We couldn't just sit back, and because of the scalability, if we really wanted to, and when we were 7 million, I wanted to double our size. Okay. So how are we going to do that within a reasonable amount of time? Okay. And so we had to have more of a strategic approach to growth, more of opportunistic type things, and get more focused on that. And while still doing two more mergers along the way, we have been much more strategic about that. Okay, looking much more selective, much more strategic, trying to bring in something that adds real, like a service line or something that we don't already do that would really enhance our firm. And I'll talk about that as we get into more detail here. But the transformational point, really the hurdle point, really came about 2012. How are we going to carry this forward? Okay, how are we going to become a really leading growth firm that has the right opportunities for our people? And that's where we kind of got started.
So Gale came aboard around 2012, right?
Right.
Gale, when you came into the firm, what did you find? What was going on?
I found a firm that was not a large firm, but a large thinking firm. Jeff has always had a vision of, even though he's not particularly a very large firm, he's very large thinking in his head. So the vision and the desire to take that large thinking and convert it into a methodology, a process to really drive high growth is what I found. And he hit the nail on the head when he said strategic, because a lot of firms will get stuck with the tactical, individual contribution, generalist point of view. You know, banker breakfast, lawyer lunch, book of business partners, you know, just get them all whipped up and enthused and, you know, on January 1st, go out and sell some business. And Jeff realized that it was much more than that. It was very much strategic, was very much leader-driven and team-based, and very much a specialist. And he knew that. He had that vision in his head. He didn't necessarily know how to execute it in particular, but he already had the seeds planted there as to what strategic growth might be. He knew what he wanted. He just didn't know necessarily what the path was to get there.
I would add to that that we were really at a point where I had developed and Keith had developed our firm primarily under the old school of thinking, you know, going to, you know, networking with bankers, the lawyer lunches, all those things that we had done. And that was our growth engine, plus, you know, salting in a couple of mergers. That's how we had grown. Okay. But you could see that just even the people who would be executing this, that we had to have a much more formalized, a much more strategic, a much more focused effort in certain areas. And that's where, you know, our need was to look at something more, just more objectively, and not just do a shotgun approach where you try to, and also client selection is another part of this. You know, you want to get the right clients, not just take everything that would come in, because, you know, you get to 7 million by taking just about anything that's got, you know, two arms and two legs, you know, and so you got to get past that mindset and realize that the value that you're providing as a firm can be much, if it's much more focused, it's much more valuable.
Well, Jeff, so, you brought an unusual kind of discipline and mindset to grow in a firm. And that apparently impressed Gale tremendously. How did you two decide to actually start doing business together?
Well, she came out to our firm. We engaged her to come out and give a you know, kind of an all-day kind of a growth seminar, really kind of an extended version of what she had given, you know, at the management summit and other events, and really kind of get us all aligned into really, first of all, the need to do this, the strategy behind it, and what we would need to, you know. So it was really, and I think it was worthwhile to do that. Obviously, I had some knowledge of Gale, how she thought, how she operated. I'd seen her at various events. So I knew that it was worth doing this. But, you know, we obviously made an investment to bring her in and kind of really go through this and see if it made sense for us to move forward.
Gale, when you came in and you found a firm that had a certain mindset, but was not necessarily in the right shape, what were the first things you saw that needed to be done?
Well, the first thing that I saw was, even though Jeff had this vision of a strategic approach to growth, he had a very young crew. So the firm is a young firm. We didn't have a lot of seasoned partners. And so, and a firm that's Jeff's size doesn't have a lot of people, to choose from in terms of how do you transform this. But he did have some really interesting, key, young, up-and-coming people who were able to grab onto it. And one of the things that I look at when I come in for the day is to see what have they got already? What are the natural assets and resources that they have? And I saw that was a natural resource, these young up-and-comers, some of whom had great potential for the future. The key thing in getting a firm transformed to a strategic approach to growth is to organize them in a specialized way, kind of like a football team. So if you have a bunch of golfers playing golf, you know, that's one thing. I wasn't in there to teach them better golfing. I was in there to actually teach them the game of football. It has, you know, the coaches on the sideline, which are industry and service line leaders, the formulation of people into industries and service lines, the identification of which ones would be the ones that have the most market appeal by teaching them a methodology of looking at the market from the outside in through teaching them a research call technique and teaching them the three elements of strategic growth with a very key component being distribution channels. So transforming them from looking at referral sources to looking at distribution channels. And those were some of the key things that I worked with him over the period of many, many months, coming in once every 6 weeks for about a day and working with Jeff and with the key people that we identified.
Jeff, what do you think were the most important tools that Gale gave you?
I would say just a focus on, as she mentioned, the focus on the distribution channel, not on referral sources, but also I would say looking at things more analytically, looking at where are your strengths, not only just in terms of your client mix, but where are your most profitable clients? What are your most profitable engagements? What do you do best? You know, and the concept is, let's figure out what we do best and do more of it, okay? And then we can, really expand and become a known quantity within those particular areas. I would say that she helped us with our proposal process, that we did, how we engaged with clients, how critical that is, and how we go from, client opportunity planning and that as well. Also, a pipeline process that she introduced to us as well, so that we are really, and this has really helped us in a number of ways, where if we have an opportunity that comes up in our pipeline meeting, we may know, it's just the typical, it's much more collaborative. It's not somebody one-off trying to go out and bring in a client. We're trying to bring in the client as a firm, and we're trying to operate as a firm. So a lot of there's some tactical things here, and then there's a more analytical way of looking at it as opposed to just, again, trying to get every opportunity, trying to get as many opportunities as you can, have a more narrow focus and try to operate in that manner.
Yeah, what was the pace or the momentum of the engagement with Mowery and Schoenfeld? Did it start slow and build, or did it start fast and steady out?
It was a fairly typical pace and rhythm, and that is because all of the various things that need to be learned, like analytics through financial analysis and market segmentation, and you go on and on. It's very challenging in the beginning for most firms. It is a brand new vocabulary. It is a brand new way of thinking. And the whole process is one of changing their thinking to change their behavior, to change their results. And so it was, like most engagements, kind of through, I call it, the beginning of it is very exciting and everybody learns new stuff. And then there's this, the messy middle, I call it. All the pieces are laying around. We don't understand how they fit together. What does this look like? And then coming out the other side, because at some point firms will say, I can take it on my own, or we've got enough. We've got to absorb this. We've got to digest it, which was the tip of what went on at Mount. Other times, it is extended over a longer period of time and very slow. And it's like, we need you, we need you, we need you. And so I never know what it's going to look like. But for them, it was like a lot of stuff in the beginning and a lot of absorbing. And because they had younger people coming up, it was a lot. It was like giving them a advanced accounting class to people who weren't, they were at a lower level to start with. So they had a really steep learning curve to go through.
Jeff, did it feel like that? Did it feel like there was a point where all these pieces were laying around and it looked a little intimidating?
I think so. I would agree with that. And I think that we were able to put, pieces together and piece a strategy together, if you will, continuing that analogy. And it did seem, we have to be persistent, I think, is, a good, I think all salespeople are, to a certain degree. You have to have a certain degree of tenacity to kind of get through things. And so I think it helped that we are persistent and focused on what the end result is going to look like as well. So yes, it was there were some pieces laying on the floor for sure, definitely. And we've been able to move it along and do quite well as a result of what we've learned.
Jeff, what was the hardest part?
I would say getting all the data together is yeah. Because this is a very data driven process, okay? And as accountants, okay, we tend to be perfectionists with regard to data and numbers, and I think we had to learn that it has to be close enough, so it's a mulligan or what, you'll use a golf, and it doesn't have to be right through the uprights. It can be, we want to make informed decisions, but we don't have to get things down to the nth degree. And as accountants, we have a tendency to do that. And the main, we don't want to get immersed in that and lose our strategic focus.
I learned a lot through that process also around the data analytics. And that is that I started seeing a themes in my firms that they were all continually frustrated with the data. So now when I go into a firm, I do things a little bit differently. First of all, we have the CFO in the room from the first, day one or some facsimile thereof. And then I also tell them on the front end, these numbers are going to be wrong. They're going to be wrong. And you've got to be okay with that. So it was a really good learning experience when I saw the frustration that his people had, especially because many of the firms I work with don't have that younger component to it. I usually have a lot of gray hairs in there and then a few young up-and-comer type people. Jeff's was different. And so as a result, they struggled even more than most. And now I know on the front end to look for a firm that has mostly young people and to know it's going to be a very steep climb. And secondly, I always know that they're going to want to have the numbers done to the gnat's whisker. And on the front end, I can say, it's never going to happen. Jeff gave me some feedback and he said, you need to give them a certain deadline and say, after that, we're done, which is, Jeff, now what I do. After X amount of time, weeks, a couple of months, 3 months, we're done. Whether you're done or not, we're done. It's as good as it can be. And that's been very helpful.
So in the process, you learn from each other.
Consultants always want to go back and work with clients that they had long ago because they're so much better from all the lessons that they learned from the early ones.
Well, I think that learning from each other is really important because if you have a collaborative engagement, okay, that is really the most effective engagement where you are both on, to some degree, on a journey, okay? It may not, and maybe your consultant is helping you facilitate your going through, but you're kind of going through the journey together. And I think that's a more effective way because you really get to a great result as a result of the engagement.
Jeff, did you learn anything about consulting to your clients from the way you were consulted to?
I think so, to some degree. Again, much more of a, and I could see this, especially some of our younger partners, in the way that they really roll out new initiatives and things, that it is, to some degree, there's a productization process, if that's a good way to do it, where I see that where like we rolled out a couple years ago, we started as part of our business tax initiative doing like research credit studies and cost segregation. And the way that we productize those for a deliverable into the client, you can see that we can apply some of those skills. I think also just in general, we're a lot, I think accountants by nature tend to be very internally focused, okay? And I think just the overall thing is we are much more externally, what does the, very focused on, and this is pretty much across the firm, put ourselves in the shoes of the client. What do they need? How can we best help them, through this process, whatever that is? And so we have, we've always had that approach of being a client-centric deliverable. But I think that this really helped us enhance that and really taught some of our younger people who are rolling out some of these initiatives that we're talking about, really focus on getting some consistency and in the deliverable. So that's where I think we learned that from you.
Gale, in terms of deliverables, when were you sure that it was all working?
When Jeff approached me about a year and a half ago and he said, we're on fire with growth, and he thanked me. Because, the reality is that as a growth consultant, a lot of the benefits are long after I leave. My firm's graduate program, and they know what they're supposed to do, and they got it on their own. And now they're, they only achieved a portion of the benefits while I was there. And so I was very excited. And then, again, about 6 or 8 months ago, he saw me again in a company and said, we are absolutely on fire. And I'm like, yay, yay. And he said, we want you to come in for a tune-up. And as a matter of fact, I came in for a tune-up a month ago, and it was so gratifying to see that change in mindset, change of behavior, and now change in results, because often I'll see the beginning, I'll see the mindset changing, and I'll see some of the behaviors changing, and a little bit of the results, but now, here we go, a few years later, and I can see the benefit of all that, and it was really exciting to see. It really was wonderful.
That sounds terrific. I could give you a couple of examples of that as well. Like as we have had, and where I think the real advantage has come in is opportunities have come up. Okay, that come up naturally in the course of a CPA firm. We had the opportunity through one of our younger partners to get involved with transaction services and sort of in a form of entrepreneurship through acquisition that one of our younger partners really developed. And we really applied, the Crosley principles in sort of developing that service line, which is, and put forth of that as well. Another example would be, as I alluded to earlier, business tax. We had one of our younger partners, he was really driving that service line within our firm. He developed the cost segregation. He developed the research credit studies and our ability, the whole way that we took out our took advantage of the 2017 tax law. All these things are applying those principles where we're looking at it very strategically. We're looking at it and we're thinking of client opportunity planning and other things that we can do to do that. But what I think was it, and I haven't really even, I was just thinking about it in preparing for this call. As I mentioned earlier, we had really, for the most of our time, we had two rainmakers, Jeff Mowery, Keith Schoenfeld, okay? But what this has enabled us to do is we now have two people who are younger. One is 32, one is 37, who in their own way, by following these principles, have become real rainmakers. They're not going out and necessarily, to the banker breakfasts and all these things and the lawyer lunches and stuff. What they're doing is strategically, positioning our firm within various industries and within various, conferences and different things. And they're taking advantage of that. And so where I think that we've got now, we've got multiple rainmakers now that have just kind of come through the process. It's a lot easier, I think. It's because it's a process that, you always, the question comes up, is business development a learned skill or is it a natural skill? Okay, and there's probably some of both, okay, in that. But I think that having this process can take someone who is, probably a little more reserved, okay, and can make them into a superb person that you literally is beating down the door. So, if you said, what is the one thing that was really helped us is that we got out of the mindset of everything is being done by the founders, all the business development is being done by the founders, and hey, we've got now a team. We've got also Gale, coached us in hiring a marketing team or developing a marketing team. We have a marketing director. We have a marketing coordinator. We've increased our overall presence across social media, across a variety of things, and all that. It's just and I don't know, Rick, how it all fits together. You said if you did this, what's the ROI on that? I can't think like an accountant. Okay, I can't operate. I just know that all these years are putting together, all these different things are happening. Okay, and the results are great. So what? And it could be better, and it will be better. But I think the most the real thing was we've got bringing in Gale. We've got a couple of other things that are in development, our international, we participate very actively in our international association, and we did kind of the Gale approach, which is you go all in, you study the industry, you study the players, and that is just exploded in this last 12 months. It took time, okay? It took investment, to go to different events, and you'd be speak at different things, and all these different things. But you can just see that, it's like bamboo, okay? You grow an inch a year, and then like the fifth year, you grow 5 feet. And that's how this has worked, And so we have an initiative in Outsource CFO, which we have really been promoting and doing. And like our three largest client engagements in the last fiscal year were all Outsource CFO engagements. So we brought in a firm in 2014 that did that, that was doing that work and applying the principles, Gale's principles, with what the expertise that came in from that firm. That's what made it work. That is what has really So I would say overall, the most important thing is that this has allowed us, when we see an opportunity, we're managing it better. We're executing it better because we have these principles of, you know, using financial analysis, getting early adopters into the thing. So those are important factors.
Well, that sounds interesting because you've taken what Gale has taught you or talked about with you about growth strategy and applied it in some way to your mergers and acquisition strategy as well.
Absolutely.
How's that working out?
Well, we did a merger in 2014 and a merger in 2016. And both of those were, you know, probably the most important thing, a couple things that we wanted to look at in that. Number one, is the target doing something that we don't do? Okay. And in the case of the firm we merged in 2014, they were very big in this outsource CFO. They had some really great clients. And then more recently in 2016, we had we brought in a one-man firm that was very, it had a very high-end client base that did a lot of work in the private client area. So now, using the principles of Gale, we're going to take that and really kind of develop like a family office type offering. We have our early adopter that we're working with now. We have the people, you know, in place to execute that. And so that's kind of like the next stage would be another thing that opportunity that has developed. So I would say our merger activity is more opportunistic now. Okay. More thoughtful. Okay. Because, you know, as I mentioned, we had a merger. The second merger we did was not a very good one. We went to MBA school on mergers on that deal and it had a lot of pain points. And said, you know what, and really that's what really spawned this whole thing was, you know, we're going to do it. We got to do this differently. We can't just add on revenue and without any strategy at all or anything. So you can see that we apply, as we, you know, pursued firms, and we still would be interested in, you know, one of the ways we're going to double is we're going to find some firm to merge in here too. But it's got to be the right firm, and it's got to be the right thing that really is accretive to what we're already doing here. And now it's got something that we can then take those principles and apply them into that new service line or whatever it happens to be.
Yeah, Jeff brings up a really interesting facet of the growth strategy thinking, which is beyond sales and marketing and internal or organic growth. How does today's growth strategies, as you understand them, overlay or map to the M&A activity going on in the profession right now? There probably could be a lot smarter deals done out there these days.
Oh, for sure. When I hear about mergers and I ask people about why are you doing that and I hear the reasons why, I often am cringing inside because it doesn't make sense to me. It's not based upon generally accepted growth principles. And generally accepted growth principles are as important as GAAP is in accounting. And once you know them, and Jeff has, you know, adopted them within his firm, you know those principles, then you'll always, one of them, for example, is look at the market from the outside in. You know, you might want to go down the road of cybersecurity and go find a cybersecurity firm. But what if you went out and interviewed several people out in your market or markets, and you found that nobody wanted to buy cybersecurity because they weren't going to have a breach? So you're getting ready, you know, and you're strategically going down a road that the market isn't ready for yet, for example. And that growth principle of looking at the market from the outside in is one of many, many that they've adopted and are utilizing. And they know that if you aren't true to the principles, you're going to end up in some strange place somewhere with investments in time and money that are not going to produce the return and the rewards. And it's even more important right now with all these six technologies that are hitting us. You know, which ones are the right ones? And this methodology, this model, the Crosley process, is a beautiful foundation for making decisions about, are you going to go down the road of data analytics or blockchain or cyber or continuous audit? Where are you going to go? What markets are you going to bring it to and what use cases? And if you use the principles, you will not end up confused and you will not end up spending time and money on ventures that are not going to provide you the return.
If I could make one other comment, you know, one thing that that really has driven the success of our couple of initiatives that we've done that have really fueled us is that we have built a team that of the people you know, like for instance, in transaction services, we now have five people working in that area of our firm, which has allowed the really kind of the principal or the service line leader to really focus all this time on business development. Okay, but in order to, you know, we live in a world of accountants. Okay, we still do that. So in order to support the business case for adding those extra people and doing those things, you've got to have the data to support it. You've got to have the analytics. You've got to have the business plan and the thoughtfulness to do that, because, you know, the partners in the firm are skeptical and say, well, why, you know, we're making an investment here, and I'm not sure this is how this is going to turn out. So you have to have data to support your initiatives. And so that's, again, you know, as you build the team, these things took off on the business tax. You know, we built a team of people that do cost segregation now. We are people that do R&D credits. We have an international team. So we've hired people with the idea that we can see the growth. We need data. We're supporting it with data. But again, management, you still have to make the case to management that this makes sense. And this process helps us do that.
And it's not something that they sit around in a conference room and think big thoughts, or, you know, put a business plan together because it's based on what they think. I call that a yowie. Your opinion, while interesting, is irrelevant. And what I say is go out in the market, interview the market, find out what people in the market think, and that's the data he's talking about. You know, tell us how big the market is, how many buyers are out there, and give us real live input from interviews. Not some, you know, marketing company that they hire and go do a bunch of interviews. I'm talking like the segment leader goes out and interviews people in the market and reports back in. This, I feel confident, this is what the market wants, and at a deeper level than just a survey or something.
When you first look at a firm, what are the preconditions for success that have to be in place?
So the key is a managing partner or facsimile thereof that has the fortitude and the appetite to get through. It is dependent upon that managing partner, me, and then if they have a marketing person, the marketing person, the three of us will either make it happen or not, because it's such difficult work, doing transformation work, that all three of us, that concept earlier about the team, the, you know, being in alignment and so forth, is so critical that if one of those pieces is a weak link or non-existent, or somebody, you know, in the middle of it loses their appetite for it, we won't be able to get it done. But other than that, all the other pieces can vary pretty significantly. Size, you know, partner lineup, ages of people, locations. We can be in some small, teeny, weeny little towns, or we can be in Chicago. I mean, all that other stuff is not as relevant as that piece right there.
That essential core of people with passion and vision.
The managing partner, Gale Crosley, and the marketing person. Mm-hmm. Those three people.
Yeah. And Jeff, the transformation continues at the firm. Continues to grow exponentially. You plan on doubling in the next 5 to 6 years. It sounds like an imperative in order to keep the people you have and keep the momentum you have. Some of that will be organic. Some of that will be mergers and acquisitions. What will this firm look like in 5 or 6 years?
Well, I think we'll be between 30 and 40 million. I really believe it. I think we'll have probably at least five more partners, and probably more that may come from a merger. But we'll be twice the size we are today, and we'll have we'll be more of a regional firm. Probably we have an office in Lincolnshire, Illinois, which is north of Chicago. We have an office in Chicago, and we will be in a position to either expand further in the Chicago metropolitan area, or, you know, to another city in the Midwest. So I think that we can bring these principles into those decisions and help us move things forward as well.
Thank you. Gale, you think he can do it?
Oh, there's no doubt. I know he can. No doubt.
Jeff, for any other accounting firm that's thinking a little bit like you're thinking, what do they need to know? What would you tell them?
Well, I think the main thing I would say is you got to be persistent. Okay, you got to look towards the end result, and you have to take a leap of faith. Okay, that you are going to be able to do this. Okay, and the ROI, as I said earlier, is not always measurable. You know, you bring on a marketing a director or something. Well, where's the payback on that? Well, the payback is more likely is indirect. Okay, it's one of the gears in a machine that is going, and you don't know if you didn't have that gear or not. So, you know, I think it helps if you're willing to go all in and have an investment mentality that if we build this and we have the right strategy, it's all going to work out. I mean, part of it is just that leap of the entrepreneurial leap that we know that we're going to take it and we're going to go forward.
Yeah, he's talking about an entrepreneurial leap, a leap of faith. Is that what's required?
Yes, it is. It's kind of like, I liken it to going to a doctor who says, if you do thus and such, these are going to be the results. But it's not like this instant pill you take. You know, you're going to need to, an example, I'm a runner. Many years ago, things weren't going so well with my back. And the doctor said, you better get into Pilates or you're not going to be running for as many years as you would like. And so I didn't know that he was right. I trusted him, and Jeff knows this because he's a Pilates aficionado as well. it's kept me running all these years. And so it's that leap of faith that, you know, you find someone who you think that they know what they're doing. You go and vet them out. It looks like the results are there. And you vet out, you know, you think long and hard about, can we do this in this firm? And collaboratively, you know, we figure out, is this the right time for your firm? Can it be done in your firm? And then you take that leap of faith. Yes.
Well, we've got a fitness plan for firms, and we've got a fitness plan for people. Any last words? How do we summarize this, Jeff?
I would say, I can say with absolute certainty that we would not have doubled our revenue in the last 5 years but for this program. I can absolutely say that, okay? And some of it came through, as I said, some of it came through mergers, some of it came through organic growth, but we are in just a much better place than we were. You know, now we're in, and it's like a building thing. You know, you think, well, I'm pretty confident we're going to, you know, Gale's confident in us, but I'm pretty confident in ourselves that we have the team and the people and the processes in place to get to where we want to be.
Gale, how do we summarize this?
You know, I always love it when the client has the last word. I have nothing more to add.
and they're terrific words of confidence and success. Well, thank you both very much.
Thank you
for joining us today. Jeff Mowery in Chicago, Gale Crosley in Atlanta.
Yes, Atlanta.
And I'm Rick Telberg at CPA Trendlines in New York.